Well, good evening. We have a full house. Welcome to the second event in this year's Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, director of the whole centre, which puts the series together. It's our great pleasure this evening to bring you best-selling author, editor, radio and TV personality, Sarah Vowell. Ms. Vowell will take questions after her talk. If you would make your way to one of the two microphones in the aisles. Afterwards, in the Jayhawk room, which is diagonal to this auditorium, there's a reception for our guest speaker, who will also sign copies of her books. Do please join us there. To introduce Sarah Vowell, there was only one person I wanted, and that is Laura Lawson. Laura Lawson's voice is well known in northern and northeastern Kansas. She's currently the afternoon host for Kansas Public Radio, the person who informs so many of us when the weather turns ugly, as it does quite often. She's originally from Louisville, Kentucky. She came to Kansas in 1983 when her father was transferred to Kansas City, and she graduated from Olathe South High School. She went on to study various liberal arts disciplines at KU, where she graduated in 1989 with degrees in anthropology, classics, and philosophy. She also holds graduate degrees in anthropology and philosophy from the universities of Kentucky and Minnesota. She worked for National Public Radio in Washington, D.C. throughout the 1990s on the programs Talk of the Nation, Morning Edition, and All Things Considered. Laura returned to Kansas in 2001 with her husband, a native Topekan, and has been working for Kansas Public Radio ever since. She contributes occasionally commentary essays for the national feed of All Things Considered. She's also the host of KTWU Public Television's high school quiz program, Quest, as part of her personal mission to convince people that education is something that is lifelong and means more than just a grade on a transcript. Education, she believes, should be a tool for enabling us to experience and manage the complexities of the world. Please welcome Laura Lawson.
Some people have very, very interesting dreams. They always fly, or they're winning the lottery, or they're eating ortolans. I don't know what they're doing, but it's always something exciting. I am not one of these people. My dreams are always very, very mundane, just going through the normal business of the day, but sort of in a parallel universe, because invariably there's one thing that's completely out of place. So I want to tell you this story. A couple of months ago, I had one of these weird workaday dreams, and in it, I was watching Monday Night Football, and John Madden was still the host, and in the dream, he said, "Now we're going down to our sideline reporter," and that reporter was Sarah Vowell. The dream, Sarah, was asking the football players on the sidelines a series of questions that were kind of complicated, and they had to do with history and literary theory. And the one I really remember from this dream is she said to this enormous man, "Henry David Thoreau once said, any man more right than his neighbors constitutes a majority of one already. Don't you think that's kind of creepy?" And the football guy said, "Yeah, we're having some trouble picking up good reads on the pass rush." And then she went on and said, "Well, what do you think Herman Melville can tell us about single-minded pursuit of a goal? I don't mean like in Moby Dick because it's really obvious, but like more like Bartleby the Scrivener." He said, "Well, we just want to play hard and leave it all out there on the field." She said, "Okay, thanks." So when I woke up, I turned to my husband and said, "I think I just had one of those parallel universe dreams. Sarah Vowell's life didn't take a hard right turn, and she's suddenly a sports journalist, right?" Now, I mention this because if that dream were a movie, I would totally watch it again. And honestly, if any of you have any kind of pull with ESPN, I'd really appreciate it if you'd get right on that. Because Sarah is a person who would just do the hell out of that job, or actually any job that had to do with sports and talking. Her bio will tell you she is originally from Muskogee, Oklahoma, which works because so many interesting storytellers have come from Oklahoma, like Woody Guthrie and Wayne Coyne. And her family then moved to Bozeman, Montana, which works because everyone I've ever met from Bozeman is kind of monumentally cool. Her academic record will tell you that she has studied modern languages, literature, and art history. Now, her agent will tell you, and I'm sure will be gratified to know that I'm using his work, that she is the author of 6 nonfiction books on American history and culture, an occasional essayist for the New York Times, a former contributing editor for years for the radio program This American Life, the voice of Violet Parr in the Academy Award-winning film The Incredibles, and an original contributor to the unspeakably great Timothy McSweeney's Quarterly Concern. She is also the president of the board of directors of 826 NYC, the Brooklyn branch of a terrific organization, which if you don't know about them, when you leave here, go look it up, okay? This is an organization sponsoring writing programs and drop-in tutoring centers for kids in some of the larger cities all around the nation. Just a little aside, if you check their website, you visit their store, the Brooklyn Superhero Supply Company, you will become the greatest aunt ever. Okay, that's just my experience. What I, however, would tell you is that Sarah Vowell is a writer who uses information to invite a conversation, to invite thought and interaction and compassion, rather than one who just uses knowledge of history and popular culture to bludgeon and alienate people who know rather less than she does. It is not surprising at all to me that she's attained a kind of cult status among people who listen to public radio. As many of you who have been forced to endure many pledge drives with me may recall, I say all the time that I really believe that radio is the most intimate of the mass media. We listen to radio in our private spaces, when we're alone, when we're in the car, in the bathroom, in the kitchen, in the bedroom, when we're falling asleep, when we're waking up. It is a privilege to speak to people in these spaces, to speak directly to you, right into your ears sometimes, if you have the little earbuds. We as listeners don't allow just anyone to do that. To be a person who can connect with you through the medium of writing, through the medium of television, but especially the medium of radio, is extremely rare. It's special, it isn't easy, it's a balancing act, particularly when you have something important to say about who we are and who we can be. I want to wrap up with a very quick story that I'm pretty sure Sarah doesn't know. I used to work for All Things Considered at NPR in Washington in the 90s, and one of the days I was acting as the show's main editor, and the day's senior producer came in with a reel of tape. His name is Sean Collins, if you ever meet him, he's awesome. And this was back in the days when we still used reel of tape because I'm so old. And at any rate, he said to me, here's something interesting that Ira just sent down the line from Chicago. I want you to hear it. Tell me what you think. And this was the tape of Sarah reading her essay on how she hoped Frank Sinatra would be remembered after he died. He was, of course, still alive at the time. And anyway, this was the first time I had ever heard Sarah's work. I thought it was great. It was smart. It was funny. It addressed the stupid way entertainment reporters deal with the death of a monumentally important cultural figure, how it differs almost not at all from, you know, the cultural figures who aren't so much. But here's the thing, this piece was so clearly fond of pop culture and people who like pop culture and, you know, fond of Frank Sinatra. And I don't just mean the Frankie of the Bobby Soxers and the one that the music critics all love. I mean ring-a-ding-ding Frank. I mean hanging out with Jilly Frank, okay? So I turn to Sean and I say, okay, this is great, we have to run this. And he's all, I know, right? So now all we have to do is convince the executive producer. Okay, good luck with that. We go around all the edit booths, and we see all the assistant editors and assistant producers, and then gradually more senior people, and we realized, wow, everyone under the age of 60 does not get this piece, or thought that the topic was morbid, whatever. We ran it, it was great, listeners loved it. And not very many stations were actually carrying This American Life at the time, so I'm particularly proud of and brag all the time that I had an incredibly minor role in helping bring her voice to more people that day. A familiar voice, a friendly voice, an erudite voice, a voice that uses words worth hearing, words that you want to hear, words that you want to listen to, words that you want to hear more. So let's listen. Please welcome author, historian, cultural observer, word wielder, Sarah Vowell.
see. Hello, good evening. And hello to the overflow room. Let's see. So, I'm here to do some humanities. And I'm going to start with doing a little bit from my most recent project, which is about 19th century Hawaii and America taking it over. And I don't know if this is interesting to you. It is to me reading it here, because in some ways I see what happened, especially in 19th century Honolulu, is sort of what happened in this town, which one writer described Honolulu as a sort of suburb of Boston, and they're basically these two places, your town and that one, where a bunch of self-righteous, churchy, Budinsky New Englanders swoop in and take over. For better or worse. Why is there a glop of macaroni salad next to the Japanese chicken in my plate lunch? Because the ship Thaddeus left Boston Harbor with the first boatload of New England missionaries bound for Hawaii in 1819. That and its Saturday Rainbow Drive-In only serves show you chicken 4 days a week. A banyan tree in Waikiki is a fine spot for a sunburned tourist from New York City to sit beneath and ponder the historical implications of a lukewarm box of takeout. Because none of us belong here. Not me, not the macaroni, not the chicken soaked in soy sauce, not even the tree. Here in Waikiki, the U.S. Army Museum is hunkered down in the midst of all the concrete high-rise hotels and condominiums built in the post-1959 statehood architectural style I like to think of as a very Brady brutalism. The park where my plate lunch and I are sitting appears in an old black and white photograph on display there. The picture was taken in the summer of 1898, a few days after the sons of missionaries who had dethroned the Hawaiian queen handed over Hawaii to the United States. The park is pitched with the tents of the 1st New York Voluntary Infantry. In the Spanish-American War, had the soldiers stopping off in this suddenly American city en route to the Philippines to persuade the Filipino people at gunpoint that self-government really isn't for everyone. They named their encampment after the president who dispatched them here, Camp McKinley. The United States declared war on Spain in April of 1898. By August, the McKinley administration had invaded the Spanish colonies of Cuba, Puerto Rico, the Philippines, and Guam, and annexed Hawaii. In this four-month orgy of imperialism, the United States became a world power for the first time, became what it is now. Hurrah for Hawaii, Theodore Roosevelt wrote from Cuba when he heard the news that the U.S. annexed the islands. He was in the Caribbean with the Rough Riders licking the Spanish at Santiago de Cuba. One of the end results of that conquest was American control of Guantanamo Bay. To Roosevelt and his like-minded cronies in the government and military, the most important objective of all the 1898 maneuvers was possession of far-flung islands for naval bases at strategic ports like Guantanamo and Honolulu's Pearl Harbor. He and his friends had pined for these bases for years, the way a normal man envisions his dream house. All they ever wanted was a cozy little global empire with a few islands here and there to park a fleet of battleships. That Japanese dive bomber sank four of those battleships in Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941, is how I ended up getting interested in Hawaii in the first place a few years back. The purpose of my initial visit was a quick jaunt to see the USS Arizona Memorial, the monument in the harbor perched above the oily, watery grave of the sailors who died on the ship that day. Unlike the flip-flop wearers on my flight to Honolulu, and why they're called slippas. I did not come here for direct sunlight or fun. I came to Hawaii because it had been attacked. And after I checked the Arizona off my to-do list, I still had some time to kill, so I swung by the Iolani Palace downtown, curious to take a look at the Victorian building my guidebook billed as the only palace in the United States. A guide led my tour group into the room where the white businessmen and sugar planters who had staged a coup d'etat against Queen Liliuokalani in 1893 locked her up for treason after her royalist supporters botched a counter-revolution. Liliuokalani whiled away her imprisonment in a room on the second floor of the palace, sewing a colorful quilt that is on display there. Perhaps out of melancholy or spite, little flags of the Kingdom of Hawaii stand guard around the quilt center square. In one corner, she embroidered a scene of a cartoonish man struggling with an umbrella, losing his hat in the wind. The guide chuckled over this quaint bit of slapstick, but I wondered if it was the sly lament of a woman whose crown has blown away and it isn't coming back. I should mention that I was there in December of 2003. The week before I arrived in Honolulu, American soldiers captured Saddam Hussein, who was hiding in his grungy spider hole outside of Tikrit. So when I was standing in the Victorian-era cell of a Polynesian queen deposed by the sons of churchy New Englanders, at that exact moment, the Iraqi dictator was behind bars in a U.S. military compound being guarded by Pennsylvanians. Not that the queen, a constitutional monarch and accomplished musician famous for writing the love song Aloha Oe, and Saddam, a mass murderer famous for gassing 5,000 Kurds, had much in common. But still, there's an identifiable link between the two overthrows, an American tendency to indulge in what trendy government lingo at the time was calling regime change. When the Iolani Palace tour guide mentioned the day the Hawaiian flag on the palace grounds was lowered and the American flag went up, she looked like she was going to cry. And I couldn't help but picture that scene from the TV news earlier in the day when a U.S. soldier celebrated the invasion of Baghdad by climbing up a statue of Saddam and covering his bronze mustached face with the stars and stripes, a gesture that was both unfortunate as PR and improper flag etiquette. It was telling to spend the morning at an historic site like Pearl Harbor, one tattooed on the American memory, and the afternoon at another historic site we have forgotten entirely. The groundswell of outrage over the invasion of Iraq often cited the preemptive war as a betrayal of American ideals. The subtext of the dissent was, "This is not who we are." But not if you were standing where I was. It was hard to see the look in that palace tour guide's eyes when she talked about the American flag flying over the palace and not realize that ever since 1898, from time to time, this is exactly who we are. And what's more, Hawaii is, just as Theodore Roosevelt's circle predicted, crucial to the American Empire's military presence in the Pacific. Pearl Harbor is still the headquarters of U.S. Pacific Command, just as it was for all three of America's 20th century wars in the Pacific, with Japan, North Korea, and North Vietnam. So I started looking into Hawaii's bit part in the epic of American global domination. Americans and their children spent the 78 years between the arrival of Protestant missionaries from New England in 1820 and the American annexation in 1898 Americanizing Hawaii, importing our favorite religion, capitalism, and our second favorite, Christianity. In certain ways, the Americanization of Hawaii in the 19th century parallels the Americanization of America. Just as their Puritan forebears had set off on their errand into the wilderness of New England, the New England missionaries set sail for the Sandwich Islands, a place they thought of as a spiritual wilderness. Just as perhaps 9 out of 10 natives of the Americas were wiped out by contact with European diseases, so was the native Hawaiian population ravaged by smallpox, measles, whooping cough, and venereal disease. just as the Industrial Revolution and the building of the railroads brought in the huddled masses of immigrants to the United States. The sugar plantations founded by the sons of the missionaries required massive imports of labor, primarily from China, Japan, Korea, Portugal, and the Philippines, transforming Hawaii into what it has become, a multi-ethnic miscellany in which every race is a minority. Hence the plate lunch. Two scoops of Japanese-style rice and one scoop of macaroni salad seemingly airlifted from some church potluck in anywhere USA are served alongside a Polynesian or Asian protein such as kalua pig, chicken adobo, teriyaki beef, or loco moco, a hamburger patty topped with gravy and a fried egg, a dish presumably invented to remedy what has always been the hamburger's most obvious defect, not enough egg. Sugar plantation workers used to share food at lunchtime, swapping tofu and Chinese noodles for Korean spare ribs and Portuguese bread. That habit of hodgepodge got passed down, evolving into the plate lunch now served at diners, drive-ins, and lunch trucks throughout the Hawaiian archipelago. In 1961, the late Seiju Ifuku established the Rainbow Drive-In, the joint on the edge of Waikiki where I bought my plate lunch. Ifuku had been an army cook with the 100th Infantry Battalion. The mostly Hawaii-born Japanese-American volunteer soldiers in the 100th and the 442nd Regimental Combat Team served as segregated troops in Europe and North Africa during World War II, becoming the most decorated unit in U.S. military history and earning the nickname the Purple Heart Battalion. Their motto was, "Remember Pearl Harbor." Their argument was that they were Americans, not, as the U.S. government classified them and their families, enemy aliens. Rainbow Drive-In's menu, offering teriyaki, hot dogs, mahi-mahi, and Portuguese sausage, reads like a list of what America is supposed to be like, a neighborly mishmash. Barack Obama, the Honolulu-born president of the United States, mentioned once on a trip home his craving for plate lunch, listing Rainbow Drive-In as a possible stop. It makes sense considering that his Kansan mother met his Kenyan father at the University of Hawaii, and his mother's remarriage blessed him with a half-Indonesian sister. He's our first plate lunch president. I suppose the double-sided way I see the history of Hawaii as a painful tale of native loss combined with an idealistic multi-ethnic saga symbolized by mixed plates in which soy sauce and mayonnaise peacefully coexist and congeal tracks with how I see the history of the United States in general. I am the descendant of Cherokees who were marched at gunpoint by the U.S. Army to Oklahoma on the Trail of Tears. Yet I am also, and mostly, the descendant of European immigrants, notably Swedish peasants, who left for Kansas for the same reasons Asian and Portuguese plantation workers sailed to Hawaii. Whenever I eat plate lunch, I always think back to the lore of my Swedish great-grandfather's voyage across the Atlantic. Supposedly, the only food he brought with him on the ship was a big hunk of cheese. Then he befriended a German in steerage whose only food was a big hunk of sausage. The Swede shared his cheese with the German, and the German shared his sausage with the Swede. Growing up, I came to know America as two places, a rapacious country built on the destruction of its original inhabitants, and a welcoming land of opportunity and generosity built by people who shared their sausage and their cheese. In 1899, the British poet Rudyard Kipling published his famous poem, The White Man's Burden, about the new American empire of island colonies of new-caught, sullen peoples. 4 years earlier, when Kipling visited Washington, D.C. for the first time, he met Theodore Roosevelt. Roosevelt dragged Kipling to the Smithsonian to show off glass cases full of American Indian artifacts. Kipling later wrote, "I never got over the wonder of a people who, having extirpated the aboriginals of their continent more completely than any modern race had ever done, honestly believed that they were a godly little New England community setting examples to brutal mankind. Of the five countries the United States invaded and/or acquired in 1898, Hawaii is the only one that became a state. That said, I have come to understand that even though Hawaii has been a state since 1959 and an American territory since 1898, a small but defiant network of Native activists question the legality of both developments and do not consider themselves to be Americans at all, which is pretty easy to pick up on when they're marching past you down the main drag of Honolulu on the 50th anniversary of statehood, carrying picket signs that say, "We are not Americans." Now, I just want to read, skip ahead to this one little part where, like what I was talking about with this town and what it shares with Hawaii, and what I've been working on the last few years. So before I was dealing with these New England Protestants going to Hawaii, the book that I was working on before that was about the Massachusetts Bay Colony and the Puritan settlement of Boston and their kind of invention of American exceptionalism and how tied up with that their idea, their ideal of themselves as building Boston, that it would be as a city upon a hill. What goes along with that was this sort of missionary impulse, you know, to go somewhere and, you know, help people out. So at this point in the book, so the first boatload of the missionaries have come. They've settled on a few of the islands, the Big Island and Oahu, where Honolulu is. And one of them, the guy on the Big Island, Asa Thurston, he sends, so they need some reinforcements, they need some new missionaries, and he sends this letter back to the missionary headquarters in Boston, and this is his description of the qualities to look for in an ideal missionary applicant. He writes, "We want men and women who have souls, who are crucified to the world and the world to them, who have their eyes and their hearts fixed on the glory of God in the salvation of the heathen, who will be willing to sacrifice every interest but Christ, who will cheerfully and constantly labor to promote his cause. The request which we heard while standing on the American shores from these islands, we reiterate with increasing emphasis. Brethren, come over and help us." If I had to pick one Bible verse that students of American history should know, it is Acts 16:9. "And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, 'Come over into Macedonia and help us.'" In the middle of his second missionary journey, the Apostle Paul had a dream or a hallucination in which a Macedonian stranger pleaded for his preaching. Paul dropped what he was doing in Asia Minor and immediately sailed across the Aegean. Theologians refer to this as the Macedonian call. For example, in his letter from a Birmingham jail, Martin Luther King Jr. writes, "Like Paul, I must constantly respond to the Macedonian call for aid." Unlike Hawaii, like Macedonia, this notion of calling for help is completely in the minds of the people who go there to offer this help. Okay. For Americans, Acts 16:9 is the high fructose corn syrup of Bible verses, an all-purpose ingredient we will stir into everything from the ink on the Marshall Plan to canisters of Agent Orange. Our greatest goodness and our worst impulses come out of this missionary zeal, contributing to our overbearing, yet not entirely unwarranted sense of our country as an inherently helpful force in the world. And as with the Apostle Paul, the notion that strangers want our help is sometimes a delusion. The forerunners of the New England missionaries, the Massachusetts Bay colonists, invented American exceptionalism, scrawling Act 16-9 literally across their colony's official seal, in which, I don't know if you've seen this picture, the seal of the Massachusetts Bay Colony, it's an Indian, and over his head are the words, "Come over and help us." Literally. Now I believe the state of Massachusetts, that seal is still the Indian. It just doesn't, he just doesn't say anything. Probably because the Massachusetts Bay colony burned a lot of them to death, the ones that hadn't died of plague. But I digress. Okay. When Yale's Timothy Dwight, he was a really big deal in New England Protestantism. He's kind of Mr. Second Great Awakening. When he delivered the founding sermon at Andover Theological Seminary, Timothy Dwight praised the doctrines carried to the New World by those eminently good men who converted New England from a desert into a garden. Hoping to inspire the Puritans' godly descendants to keep on gardening, Dwight preached that "Come over to Macedonia and help us" is audibly resounded from the four ends of the earth. The nations of the east and the islands of the sea already wait for his law. Act 16:9 is the meddler's motto, simultaneously selfless and self-serving, generous but stuck up. Into every generation of Americans is born a new crop of Budinskis sniffing out the latest Macedonia that may or may not want their help. You can discuss all that later on when you get together on Massachusetts Street. Okay. How are we doing in time? Maybe I'll move on. Okay. So I thought I would read this piece that I wrote for this book edited by Grill Marcus and Sean Willentz called The Rose and the Briar, and it features one of your fellow citizens previously. Previous fellow citizen of these parts. Before I read this, I have to say, I was walking down Massachusetts Street today, and I walked by this t-shirt shop, and in the window of this t-shirt shop is a t-shirt that has a picture of John Brown on it, and it says WWJBD, and it says, "What would John Brown do?" And, I mean, I think if you really think about the answer, like, I mean, all right. During the memorial service at the National Cathedral on September 14th, 2001, those gathered in the pews to mourn the more than 2,800 people who were murdered by terrorists 3 days before sang the battle hymn of the Republic. President Bush sang it, ex-Presidents Clinton, Carter, and Bush sang it. Watching it on television in New York City, I sang it. And across the sea at another service in another church, Queen Elizabeth II sang it with tears in her English eyes, having sung the song 36 years earlier at the funeral of Winston Churchill, as Churchill himself had sung it along with FDR on the White House lawn in 1943. Because that's when we sing the Battle Hymn of the Republic, at wars and funerals. So the battle hymn was doubly appropriate on September 14th. It was a funeral and we were at war. And yet, there we were, we gathered Americans, Her Majesty the Queen, chanting this beloved battle cry at the terrorists of the world, and yet buried inside the melody of the song was the rotting corpse of an American terrorist. Here are the lyrics that used to go to that tune back in 1860, lyrics that honor the terrorist as a hero. John Brown's body lies a-moldering in the grave, his soul goes marching on. I do not throw around the word terrorist lightly, but it fits John Brown. Brown. So like the answer of that question on the t-shirt is kill. All right. So, Brown, a white man who hated slavery so much that even his friend Frederick Douglass, the famed abolitionist and former slave, wished Brown would shut up about it every now and then. Back in 1856, Brown and his men massacred five pro-slavery settlers from the South near Pottawatomie Creek, Kansas, dragging them from their homes as their wives and children looked on screaming. They hacked them up with knives, though Brown shot one man's mangled body in the head just to make certain he was dead for sure. Then, hoping to incite a slave uprising, Brown led a guerrilla attack on the federal arsenal at Harper's Ferry, Virginia, on October 16, 1859. By the time the United States Marines, under the command of Colonel Robert E. Lee, put an end to Brown's mayhem, 17 people had lost their lives, including 10 of Brown's men, two of whom were his sons. Brown was executed for this crime on December 2, 1859. Across the land, Brown's execution was either celebrated or mourned with ringing church bells, depending on which side of the Mason-Dixon line one hung one's heart. In Concord, Massachusetts, Brown's friends, including Ralph Waldo Emerson, held a service in which Henry David Thoreau called Brown a crucified hero. Thoreau was so excited about Brown's martyrdom to the abolitionist cause that he cheered that Brown's death gave people who were, quote, contemplating suicide something to live for, exclamation point. In Philadelphia, 257 medical students of Southern birth, including the future amputator of Stonewall Jackson's arm, stormed an anti-slavery prayer meeting for Brown's soul in disgust and marched straight to a depot to board a train for Richmond, where they were met by a band playing Carry Me Back to Old Virginia. And, as Lincoln put it in his second inaugural address, the war came. Then John Brown got a song of his own, sort of. Like every turn in this story, the song John Brown's Body is an accident of history. What happened was that Union soldiers, the 12th Massachusetts Regiment, were stationed at Fort Warren in Boston Harbor. As they went about their duties, the soldiers sang. One of their favorites was Say Brothers, Will You Meet Us, a Methodist hymn with a glory, glory, hallelujah chorus. There was a singing quartet in residence at the fort, Sergeant Charles Edgerly, Sergeant Newton J. Purnett, Sergeant James Jenkins, and Sergeant John Brown. One day in December of 1859, news arrived at the fort about the famous abolitionist. John Brown's dead. Some smart aleck, thinking of his singing comrade, Sergeant John Brown, is said to have replied, "But he still goes marching around." A soldier named Henry Howe Green reportedly turned this wisecrack into the first verse of the song about his comrade. John Brown's body lies moldering in the grave, his soul goes marching on. A soldier who played the organ set it to the music of Say Brothers, Will You Meet Us. So the song was a joke, joshing among soldiers, the sort of ribbing a sergeant in today's army might receive if he had the misfortune of being named Uday Hussein. John Brown's Body became the 12th Regiment's marching song. They sang it in public for the first time on Boston State Street on July 18, 1861. After that, they sang it marching down Broadway in New York City. They sang it so often, they became known as the Hallelujah Regiment. On March 1, 1862, they sang it in Virginia on the very spot the abolitionist John Brown was hanged. 3 months later, Sergeant John Brown drowned while crossing the Shenandoah River on the way to battle. Heartbroken, the Hallelujah Regiment never sang John Brown's Body again. But by that time, they were the only ones in the Union Army not singing it. Northern soldiers would sing it on parade, marching from battle to battle, sitting around campfires at night. And since no one had ever heard of Sergeant Brown, every soldier who sang the song thought he was paying tribute to the infamous abolitionist. Lyrics kept getting added on, including one doozy of a stanza about the president of the Confederacy that went, "We'll hang Jeff Davis to a sour apple tree." A few weeks before Appomattox, about 1,800 black children in Charleston, South Carolina, where the first shots of the Civil War were fired, celebrated the fact that the Confederate Army had fled the town by participating in a victory parade in which they sang John Brown's body, including the Jeff Davis hanging bit. Abolitionist Sojourner Truth had already written her own cover version of the song for Negro regiments of the Union Army to sing. And as if listening to little black girls and boys sweetly promising to lynch the Confederate president wasn't nerve-wracking enough, who knows what terror was struck in the hearts of slave owners who heard armed black men chanting Truth's boast, "We can shoot a rebel farther than a white man ever saw." In November 1861, some white abolitionists from Boston, including Mr. and Mrs. Samuel Gridley Howe and their minister, Reverend James F. Clark, were touring a Union Army base on the outskirts of the nation's capital. They heard soldiers singing about John Brown's body emoldering in the grave. As the do-gooders made their way back to their lodgings at the Willard Hotel, Reverend Clark turned to Mrs. Howe and wondered if she might like to write new, more uplifting lyrics to that fine melody of John Brown's body. Not that Julia Ward Howe had a problem with John Brown. She had even hosted Brown at dinner on one of his trips to Massachusetts to drum up money for smiting the slave mongers. Brown had thought Mrs. Howe was all flash and fire. Howe believed Brown's execution would make the gallows glorious like the cross. The window of Julia Ward Howe's room at the Willard afforded a view for an ad for a company that embalmed casualties of the war and shipped the bodies home. She would recall, "I searched for an old sheet of paper and an old stub of a pen which I had the night before and began to scrawl the lines almost without looking, as I learned to do often by scratching down verses in the darkened room when my little children were sleeping. Having completed this, I lay down again and fell asleep, but not before feeling that something of importance had happened to me." Back home in Boston, she gave the poem to her neighbor, James T. Fields, editor of the Atlantic Monthly. He paid Howe $4, gave her poem the title The Battle Hymn of the Republic, and published it in the 1862 February issue. The battle hymn became a huge hit. Soldiers and citizens alike could not stop singing it. When Abraham Lincoln heard it at a rally, it is said his eyes filled with tears and he yelled, "Sing it again." Harriet Beecher Stowe, author of Uncle Tom's Cabin, recited the battle hymn at Boston Celebration when Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1, 1863. In what is remembered as his "I Have Been to the Mountaintop" address to the Memphis sanitation strikers on the night before he died in 1968, Martin Luther King Jr.'s very last line of his very last sermon was Howe's first, "Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord." When John Steinbeck's wife, Carol, came up with the title The Grapes of Wrath for his novel about destitute Okies, Steinbeck was thrilled, not only because it's a catchy name, but because he thought wrapping himself inside the patriotism of the battle hymn might keep the fascist crowd from accusing him of being a communist. It didn't. In the hymn, a line about Christ asks, "Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel." This shout out to the Virgin Mary by way of William Shakespeare takes on an extra meaning in light of Julia Ward Howe's biography. Though she was married for 34 years, raised 6 children, and was in fact the creator of Mother's Day, Julia Howe was not without ambivalence about domesticity. For example, she wrote a poem entitled "The Present is Dead" on her honeymoon. Writing to her sister about what she called the stupor of marriage and motherhood, Howe complained, "It has been like blindness, like death, like exile from all things beautiful and good." So, in the Battle Hymn of the Republic, Howe reminds the nation that the Son of God had a human mom who did all the work. Hence, "Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel." Howe is rubbing in the fact that even Jesus had to be potty trained. Like a lot of your bigger hit songs, Battle Hymn, the Battle Hymn has been ripped off numerous times. Countless renditions have been set to its tune, which is fair enough considering that Julia Ward Howe ripped off a song that was a ripoff of a previous song. There was an 1899 update protesting the McKinley administration's incursion in the Philippines. There was Solidarity Forever, a number from the IWW songbook, a hymnal for the Union that referred to itself as the singingest union of them all. There was Gloryland, the official song for the 1994 World Cup, in which Daryl Hall of And Oates fame proclaim to the soccer fans, with passion rising high, you know that you can reach your goal. And of course, there's the playground classic known as Teacher Hit Me With a Ruler, in which students torment their teachers, mock their principal, and set their school on fire. In the 1950s, around the time of the Korean War, something else happened to Julia Ward Howe's Battle Hymn of the Republic. A word changed. The line, "Let us die to make men free," got changed to, "Let us live to make men free." The new wording acknowledged that sometimes war isn't always the answer, plus it's less of a downer. And through the years, a civil war of sorts has broken out between those who would die and those who would live. The Mormon Tabernacle Choir sings Live on its 1959 Grammy-winning recording of the song. Joan Baez, singing a sing-along at a black college in Birmingham in 1962, went with the traditional die. In my opinion, die is the way to go. When you get rid of the word die, you erase the most moving idea in the song, that if Christ died for us, we should be willing to die for each other. Why give that up? This is the one clear-cut case where you can ask yourself, what would Jesus do, and you know the answer. Die. What would Jesus do? Die. And of course, people disagree about the wording. We disagree about everything else in this country. And when we sing this song today, I think we even disagree about what the serpents are that our heels should crush. Some of us see our enemies abroad, and some see them at home. And that's the way it's been with this song all through its history. It gets adapted for one use and then another. The melody is so powerful, the words so strong, that you feel like you really would lay down your life for a just cause of your choosing. When we sing the battle hymn, and I say we because that is how the song is traditionally performed at public events, as a sing-along in which a group of citizens become a choir, we sing about taking action, about marching on, about doing something. And this is the best part about singing the battle hymn. You are not standing there alone doing something. You are part of something. The song starts off with mine eyes and I have seen, and by the end, it's you and me, and let us die or let us live, whatever, us being the point. We're all in it together, if only for the length of the song. Let's see. Maybe I can do just one more little bit, and then I'll take some questions. We'll do this. It's sort of seasonal. You know, we have that election coming up. And here's a little piece. It mentions one of your people. I like pandering. So I'll read it. It's a chunk from a longer essay. It's from 2001. It's a piece that looking back on the 2000 election. Remember that? It was. So that was what. So for those of you who were six at the time. It was this, you know, election night that went on for several weeks and had a kind of tumultuous ending, thanks to the Supreme Court. And at the time, I mean, it was the year 2000, I mean, I know a lot of you students in this room, you've certainly grown up in the world of the internet, but it was for the average Joe, it was still fairly new at the time. This was, I think I had only, at the time maybe of that election, I had maybe had a computer for 4 years, and so the internet was still, fairly novel. And for that election, I had this, I guess people do this kind of thing all the time now, but this was very new to me. So my friends and I, we decided we would be this email group, and we would email each other election updates every day. And it was really, really involved. I mean, now there's this whole class of people who are just, online all day long, like sifting through political news. And it was basically like I was more of a passive part of this group, but there were some of them, maybe nowadays they would just have their own blog about this stuff, but instead they would just, they would be online all day or watching cable news and send their five friends 14, 15 emails a day about various polls and, stuff like that. So it was like all of that was very, very new at the time. And they were all, everyone on the group was, they were supporting Al Gore. In a pretty old-fashioned kind of way. Or one of the group members called it a weird bastion of totally out-of-touch liberalism. I think so. And, I think at the time I described it as the all-time nerdiest thing I had been involved in, and I had been involved in public radio and marching band. So, after the presidential election had been decided, this guy was going to be inaugurated, the people who had been on these emails, decided to carpool down to Washington to watch it and just be there. It seemed like the culmination of this whole laborious process. Okay. Walking to the inauguration, we duck into the National Archives to look at the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution just to see if they're still there. My friend Jack chats with the guard about the nuclear-proof underground vault the documents are lowered into every night. Then it is on to the police checkpoint. Now remember, this is January of 2001, so having your stuff searched and your space invaded and your privacy and liberty completely and totally curtailed was new. So we were all completely flummoxed by all of this. So it was on to the police checkpoint. The inaugural parade route was completely blocked off, and the only way into the mall was through checkpoints where the authorities searched all bags. It is all over the news that thanks to the healthy number of expected protesters, they've banned fruit as well as sticks attached to protest signs, also giant puppets, because these things could be used to hit another person. Never mind that my club-shaped umbrella is admitted without a word, or that a president endorsed by the National Rifle Association is so apparently worried about a cantaloupe or marionette might put out some spoil sport picketer's eye. Even elderly Republican ladies are more menacing than we are because they have the guts to wrap themselves in controversial mink pelts. So we get to the muddy mall, just as Chief Justice William Rehnquist is swearing in Dick Cheney as vice president. And from where we stand, the men are faraway specks, but thanks to the CNN Jumbotron, their faces are bigger than the Capitol Dome. Rehnquist is one of the five Supreme Court justices who effectively gave George W. Bush the presidency, was a particular object of the group's email scorn. So we all boo him. Then we boo Dick Cheney, or rather, I would like to think that it's nothing personal, that we were booing the fishy process that got him there. Then Staff Sergeant Alec T. Molly of the United States Army Band sings My Country Tis of Thee. I am stunned when my friend Kevin boos him too. I ask him, you're booing the Army guy? You're booing My Country Tis of Thee? Are we against everything now? Yes, he answers. We're against everything, and boos louder. George W. Bush places his hand on the same Bible that George Washington placed his hand on in 1789 and repeats after Rehnquist that he will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. I'm sure he means it if he's actually thinking about it, but it's reassuring to have that underground vault at the National Archives as a backup. I told myself I came down to protest, but I choose to display my dissent by bursting into tears as Bush finishes up his oath. It's happened. It's over. He's it. The CNN camera pans around the dais. Seeing Bush embrace his ex-president father, seeing him shaking the now ex-president Clinton's hand, seeing Gore clapping like a sad, good sport all makes me cry harder. About the only person up there I find myself happy to look at is the former Republican senator and presidential candidate, Bob Dole. I have developed a soft spot for Dole because he symbolizes a simpler, more innocent time in America when you could lose the presidential election and, like, not actually become the president. All right. So I will take some questions if you have any. I guess the microphone, there's a microphone, and there's a microphone. You'll have to go to those microphones. Cool. Or not, I mean. I get paid either way, you know. You want to get your money's worth, it's up to you.
Can you just take a question from the crowd, man? Can you hear me?
I guess if you want to go rogue.
What are your opinions of the next 4 years, depending on each candidate is winning?
What are my predictions for the next 4 years if either candidate wins? I'm in nonfiction, you know? So it's really hard to say. I have no idea. I mean, you know, in some ways, I don't know. It just makes my head brain hurt to think about that. I mean, I'm gonna vote for one of them, and I maybe think things might be a little better if that guy were running things, but in some ways I think we do kind of blow out of all proportion the power, the effect the president has on the country. On the other hand, speaking of the 2000 election, I will say that particular president, I mean, he had a way of always surprising me, you know? Like, I really, at the beginning of his, at his inauguration, I did cry. And thinking back, I thought, I mean, what was I so upset about? I mean, I was upset about the election, but I also was worried, oh no, I bet this guy is not gonna be very good for the economy and the environment. Like, that's really the bulk of my fears. And then, I mean, look what happened, you know? Like, the apocalypse. So, I'm really the wrong person to ask, you know, to predict, like, oh, what could go wrong? Because clearly I have no clue. You know, I'm also, like, an incredibly terrible judge of character because some of the candidates I've had the most extreme feelings and affection for, Let's go down the list. Bill Clinton, Elliot Spitzer, John Edwards, you know? It's just like penises on parade. So, I mean, when I voted for Elliot Spitzer for governor of New York, I just thought, okay, this guy is a jerk, but he's a jerk for justice, you know? And I was so happy to be voting for him, because the thing I liked most about him is he didn't really care if he was likable or not. It turns out, I mean, yeah, I guess he sought approval and affection in other areas. I don't really trust myself anymore. And I don't think you should. Yes.
Hi. You've been around the U.S. and seen a lot of interesting things. What's the weirdest thing you've come across going around the U.S. for your essays and your books?
I was in Lawrence, Kansas, and they had this T-shirt. No. The weirdest? I don't know. I don't know. What's the weirdest thing you've ever seen? It's not something I catalog. I mean, there are places that are creepier than other places. Maryland, you know? I think Maryland is pretty creepy. I mean, Texas is also kind of dispiriting, certain parts of Texas. I think there's some, I mean, once I had to spend a week in Dallas, and I was coming back to my hotel and around, I don't know, day 5, and I noticed the hotel bar had a sign saying, we would prefer that you didn't bring your firearms into the bar. And I was so homesick for New York at that point where, that's just unwritten. Like, I mean, sure, some people are gonna bring guns into bars, but we, like, you know, it's just kind of an unwritten code that we just kind of don't like that sort of thing and have laws against it. And their laws are, I think, bars and churches, they can post a sign saying that. So that's sort of dispiriting. Yeah, but Maryland. I mean, I remember when I was working on that assassination book, it is like their, you know, their state song is basically a call to assassinate President Lincoln, right? I mean, it has the word "sic semper" in the state song. This state song was, you know, instituted in the 20th century, by the way, and that's the thing that John Wilkes Booth said after shooting President Lincoln. And I remember like driving around trying to find Dr. Mudd's house and being in this weird restaurant out in the country where the vegetable of the day was succotash, you know? Like the whole place just has this kind of, you know, like how John Waters films are set there. He's not as outlandish as you think he is. I hope that answers your question. I'm more than happy to talk about our beautiful national parks or something. Yes, over here.
Hi, Sarah.
Hello.
I was born in Hawaii, and I was wondering how were you so good at history?
How am I so good at history?
Yeah.
Am I? First of all, you're the first Hawaiian I've ever seen who has an American flag on her T-shirt.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah.
Are you trying to fit in here on the mainland? I don't know that I would say that I'm good at... I mean, I think some of the ways that I feel effective about writing about history is comes from my lack of breadth and depth on the subject, you know? I mean, I do kind of start from scratch with these projects, and you know, I think they're fairly informal and inviting to the reader because the reader can just learn along with me. It's not like I start out with tons of thoughts and ideas to share. They're more sort of almost journals of me satisfying my own curiosity. And then, so that way they're more informal. And then I do have a kind of fixation on a certain clarity. But I don't know that has to do with, that more has to do with me having gone to graduate school and having read a lot of bad writing, you know? I remember thinking, like, trying to parse, I went to art history graduate school, and there was a lot of, you know, gobbledygook you have to read, and trying to, like, even people with really good ideas, they couch them in incredibly infuriating language. So that sort of, I think, galvanized me into wanting to try and present my facts and ideas in a fairly clear manner. So.
Can I tell you some?
A song?
No. I can memorize the whole entire U.S. presidents without fail.
Congratulations. I mean, facts are good. I think I think it's nice to have a fact on hand.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you, Miss Val.
Thanks, sure. Hey. Hi. You with the tie on. Hi.
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 I was wondering, I think you were in the movie Incredibles.
Yeah, I kind of remember that.
A while ago. And I was wondering if you were in any other movies, just out of curiosity.
Oh, any other movies? Well, yeah. I mean, nothing worth mentioning. But there's a movie called, I have a lot of friends that make movies and TV shows, and sometimes I do stuff in their projects. Like, I had a friend who made a movie called Please Give that I have a little part in, and I think there was something. Oh, and my friend did this show on HBO called Bored to Death. I had a little part in that. And they're all, like, really tiny parts because I don't have any range. And I'm also terrible at memorization. So it's not really, it's just something I do every now and then if, you know, a buddy asks me to. But it's not anything I really like or am particularly good at. It's just a little, you know how you do those little side projects sometimes? Just because you're not really doing anything that day. Kind of that. But The Incredibles, that was a really special thing to be part of. And that, you know, those movies take so long to make. I was working on that for almost 4 years. So that was, it's one of the few actual jobs that I've had, you know, other than, like, sitting in my apartment thinking things up. So that movie definitely has a really special place in my heart. And I, you know, made a lot of good friends and learned so much. Yeah, I'm really proud of the way that turned out. Mm-hmm. Yes? Hi.
Hi.
They always set those up. I think the guys who set up microphones are always tall, and they always set the microphones up for the other talls.
Yeah, such is my life. So they say that education is expensive, but ignorance is more expensive, or... Yeah, more expensive.
I don't know. I was at Washington University the other night in St. Louis. Oh, my God. That's like $47,000 a year. Go on.
So, I don't know if this is just the case for people in general, but a lot of people my age...
How old are you?
Well, I just turned 21.
Mm-hmm.
So, they kind of indulge in that ignorance. Not all, but, you know, a lot. So what would you...
Yeah, I have a TV. No.
How would you suggest to people my age, like, how to, like, expose themselves more besides just talking to people? Because, you know, when we're in school, it's kind of difficult.
Well, first of all, I think you'll probably find there are a lot of older people that are fairly ignorant, too. It's not really an age thing. It's kind of a people thing. I don't really know. I have a sort of lucky life where, because I write books, and then I go travel around the country, and generally the people who come to my events are the people who read books. So I really only talk to the people who read books still. And so it's kind of, I do have this very narrow, probably false vision of the country. One that I'm perfectly happy to keep looking at, you know? But, I mean, you just, you can only be responsible for yourself and to be, you know, you can set some kind of example, but you can always find, you know, you can always find your people. I mean, you're just hanging out with the wrong people, you know? Like, I mean, I remember I had, like, in high school, I had these friends, these girls, and they were so dumb. And, you know, there is, like, in the social situation where you just kind of need some people to hide behind at lunch. And then just to keep make your life easier. And these people I had chosen to hide behind at lunch, they were so terrible, and all they did was say mean things about other people. I remember one day I just had enough, and I was like, I don't care if I don't have anyone to eat lunch with anymore. I can't take this anymore. And I got up from the lunch table, and I took my lunch with me, and I didn't say anything, but I was just like, I'm done with this, you know? And I sat down by myself, by my locker. And this kid, I kind of knew. He had a Robert Smith from The Cure hairdo, you know? He I don't know what he was doing, but he came on and sat down next to me and asked me if I liked The Cure. And, I mean, they weren't my favorite, but I started talking to him about music, and then he ended up being, like, part of this, you know, this group of friends that I eventually made. I'm still friends with him, actually, and, you know, that people who were in the anti-nuclear group. And so after I found them, then I really didn't care about anyone else, you know, because I had my gang. And I think it's been like that for me all through my, you know, school and job. Like when I got to college, it was the people at the college radio station. They were my crowd. And then later it was, you know, like This American Life was like that, or McSweeney's was like that. And you just have to, you can't I mean, you'll just go crazy if you just start thinking about all the people who, you know, you don't respect or admire or want to listen to. Just find the ones you do, you know? And maybe it won't be that many people, but it might be enough, I think.
Thanks.
So, yeah. Yes?
I really, really cherish your essay on guns and your dad.
Mm-hmm.
I just love that. And
thank you.
Actually, what was on my mind was Assassination Vacation. I'm wondering how long you thought about that, or how long had it been brewing in your mind before you started writing, and how long did it take?
Let's see. I mean, I think I might have worked on that book about two and a half, three years. And, I mean, I had been writing about Lincoln a bit before that, so I don't know. Maybe some of the stuff was rattling around for 4 or 5 years, but that one happened fairly quickly. Because it's just about the first three assassinated presidents, it's a pretty discrete period of time, and some of the same characters pop up. You know, like Lincoln's son being there or being in proximity for all three of them. It sort of it went at a nice quick clip.
Have you had someone that's really been a major influence in your pursuing the creative work and the writing?
Major influences. I mean, I guess probably when I was a kid, maybe Allen Ginsberg. I think the way, especially his book Howl, and how he writes about the country and puts himself in his poems, and, you know, like his poem America was a complete revelation to me as a teenager. And then later on, especially when I was first trying to make a living as a writer, I was a rock critic, so all of those, you know, old school guys like Lester Bangs, he was a favorite, and and Grill Marcus, of course. He was, you know, kind of my literal mentor. In terms of writing about history, I don't know. I mean, I probably write about history the way I used to write about pop music, and, you know, kind of veering back and forth between personal experience and more, let's call them scholarly thoughts or something. But I probably, you know, yeah, I would say somewhere between Allen Ginsberg and Lester Bangs.
Thank you so much mm-hmm. for all you've done.
Oh, thanks. Hello.
Hi. First, I'd like to say I think the guy that plays the mic stands is too short. Secondly,
that guy can't do anything right.
I said that from the beginning. I basically just want to ask, and I guess you touched on this a little bit. One of the things that I love so much about your writing is that you put historical events into current context. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that a lot of historians miss out on because they want to tell a simple A to B story, linear history. And I was just kind of curious if you set out, you say that you start from scratch, if you set out with some sort of kind of framework of what you're going to write about based on how you can relate it to kind of more contemporary time, or if you just kind of explore and then see what links to what you kind of know in current day?
I mean, it's not the only factor, but it is a factor. For example, I mean, sometimes I don't even know. You know, like I was well into that book about presidential assassinations, a book I really started working on in earnest, I believe, in 2003, and then I realized more than halfway through it, that I must be drawn to those figures because I needed to work through some of my own problems with the then president, you know? So, but usually, like with that book I wrote about Puritans, I had always wanted to write about them. Who doesn't? But because I like the sermons and especially that John Winthrop sermon, A Model of Christian Charity, in particular. So that was always in the back of my mind. And then, you know, some other things about them, more personal things about individual Puritans, had always piqued my curiosity. But then I really started working on that book after watching Reagan's funeral in 2004, when Sandra Day O'Connor was reading Winthrop's sermon, A Model of Christian Charity, at the funeral because of Reagan's association with that phrase of the city on a hill. And that just really caught me because, I mean, for starters, that sermon is all about charity and generosity, and how, you know, it's Winthrop's pep talk to his shipmates saying, basically, if we don't take care of one another, we're going to die. And that was, you know, because, you know, the Plymouth Pilgrims 10 years earlier, half of them had died in the first year. So this sermon is all about, we're going to have to take care of each other. And not just that, it's this real poem of communion and community where he says, you know, we will mourn together and suffer and labor together as members of the same body. And it is all about caring and charity and generosity. And I don't know if you remember President Reagan's administration, but it was all about shutting down every single social program having to do with charity and generosity. So there was that hypocrisy. But more than that, it was one of the most interesting things about that sermon is to Winthrop, when he says we shall be as a city upon a hill, like, it can go two ways. It's the way, it could go the way, you know, President Reagan talked about it, where, you know, we could, like, he sees Boston could be this beacon to the world, you know, this shining example of goodness. But Winthrop also sees they could fail, and the whole world could be watching their failure. And by the way, he considered that failure to be a failure if they failed to take care of one another. And it had, their funeral happened a couple weeks after the Abu Ghraib photos came out. And when, and everyone who at the, you know, top of the chain of that command who was ultimately responsible for that, was sitting there in that room listening to this sermon being read. And when she gets to the part where Winthrop says, the eyes of all people are upon us, it just seemed like that darker prophecy of Winthrop's had come true. So I guess that, like, you know, the way that that writing, the way those words, how that piece of writing was speaking to then current events, that was kind of, that's what got me going on that. But so yeah, it's a factor, but I would say.
Great, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes?
Hi, my name's Deborah Kirk, and I need to greet you formally because you said you're of Cherokee descent, so I'm Cherokee of the Cherokee Nation. I wanted to ask you... Osio, Dohiju.
The only one.
I wanted to ask you about your perspective as far as knowing that, being of Cherokee descent and knowing your ancestry of the Trail of Tears, how has that perspective influenced your way that you address history and how you approach it?
Well, I mean, in a few ways. One of them is very literal. It's sort of the, it's probably the ultimate source of my interest in history, and also I lived in Oklahoma until I was 11 years old, and every single summer of my childhood, we would go to the Cherokee Cultural Center in Tahlequah, and we would, you know, I don't know if you ever caught the amphitheater drama presentation of the Trail of Tears in the 70s, but I saw that, it was one of those big, like they used to do in the 60s and 70s, amphitheater outdoor dramas, and it was a like big pageant with lights and music and dance and drama. And so I watched this story every single summer in my childhood, and it was, you know, so riveting and so vivid to me. And also just the, so that's what I thought history was, you know, and that it was also something that wasn't something that happened to other people. It was why I was born there. And then also just literally going to where the, going to the Cherokee Cultural Center where the drama was put on was near the site of the old Cherokee Female Seminary, which my great-grandmother on my father's side attended that school. And that school building had burned down, but right outside the entrance to the theater were the remaining columns left from the building, and my mother's great-something grandfather, who came over on the Trail of Tears, he was a stonemason who helped build that building. So it was all like tied up, like the story, like the place it had in my own family's history, literally going past the, you know, building that my ancestor built, and that, you know, where my other ancestor went to school, and to watch this thing. And so there's that. And then literally, when I started writing about history, the documentary that I made, Tracing the Trail of Tears for This American Life, that was the first story I did about history. And after that, I didn't really want to do anything else. So it literally, that story, I've kind of gotten a lot out of it. It's as the bright side of what happened, I guess, for me. It's kind of like, you know, President Obama, he's gotten a lot out of us taking over Hawaii. I personally have gotten a lot out of what happened to my ancestors. But then it also, just knowing that story, I mean, it's the first historical story I knew about, I think, other than maybe, you know, the Israelites escaping Egypt. And so, you know, I went to school and learned history in that very old-fashioned, you know, rah, 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 rally around the flag wave. And so it was always this little footnote in the back of my mind, you know, of the darker side of that. So I think it probably did make me question things more. But, I mean, just more in a more personal way, it just made me feel a part of history, and that history wasn't something abstract or something that happened to other people, you know? I don't know if that answers your question.
Could I just ask you a question myself?
Sure.
What did you think about...
Sure, Hal. No. Sorry.
You thought I was a computer?
No. A British computer? No. A really classy one.
What did you think about Mitt Romney's attack upon Sesame Street and Big Bird?
Mitt Romney's attack on Sesame Street? I mean... Well, I mean, I have a lot of thoughts on it. I mean, first of all, it's just silly because that, I mean, the amount of government spending that goes into the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and then the minuscule amount of that that goes into Sesame Street is just like barely worth remarking upon statistically. And also, it seems like the section of the country that a lot of those public television stations serve are like out in the middle of the country, you know, especially in really rural areas, that sometimes some of those places, you know, without the homes without satellites, that's the only programming that children have available to them. And also, I mean, just the staggering political stupidity of, I mean, I can say one thing, okay, going after Lehrer and you know, that, I mean, I think it would have been much more politically savvy for him to go after, say, NPR. But to go after Big Bird, it was kind of like, I remember the moment in the 2000, in the New Hampshire primary. I was at the New Hampshire primary, and one of the lame softball debate questions was, which political figure do you admire the most? And I remember when Bill Bradley said Gorbachev. Like, that was the moment I knew he did not have a chance in hell. I mean, along with, you know, Vice President Gore, he was like one of the two smartest people in the lineup. But then when he said that, that was just so politically stupid, you know, because it was really only, what, like not much more than a decade after the Cold War. Like, there were a lot of other choices he could have gone with that just sounded better. It was such a softball question. And even if there are many things to admire about Mikhail Gorbachev, you don't say that at the New Hampshire primary, you know? And, like, going after Big Bird was just such a, like, I thought he was pretty masterful generally in that debate. It was the best I had ever seen him, and he was pretty good at bringing things back to, you know, real people and real examples, and obviously he had a little more je ne sais quoi than the president that night, but the Big Bird thing just seemed so silly, especially, I mean, besides all the, like, logical reasons, I mean, just about every single American, if you, like, in a country where we do not agree on anything, it's basically, there's ice cream, Big Bird, and Meryl Streep, you know? Like, who does, like, everybody likes those things, you know? I could add barbecue, but there's such a healthy contingent of vegetarians in this country. It's really like there are these very few things that are these articles of agreement, and that was one of them. It just, I don't know. I mean, it's the kind of thing where it's probably ultimately, you know, helps Big Bird out because it reminds people not to take him for granted. Yes.
So I used to work for AT6 Chicago for a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked this question so we can plug it a bit. Do you have a favorite piece of student writing from AT6 New York, or a most memorable?
From AT6 New York? Well, what we do at the various AT6 centers around the country is there are any number of ways that students can engage in writing. We have writing workshops. Then we have field trips where these classes from the public schools come in and they'll write a story together as a class, and then we publish that as a book. And then we also, we have drop-in tutoring, and a lot of the students, especially the regulars who come in every day, they after they finish their homework, then they're encouraged to write stories. I remember, actually one of my favorite, there's some examples of New York writing that I really like, but I do remember one from LA that I particularly loved, where this class of public school students from an LA elementary school had written this love story about a leopard called Leppy's Love. And there was this one line where this, I think the leopard was in love with a cheetah or something, but this one line, it was this love story, and the leopard told the cheetah, "You make my spot stay on." Yeah. Yes.
Hello. I'm reading Assassination Vacation and Charles Guiteau's justification for what he did, the kind of religious self-righteousness and the disconnect from reality and the willingness to do anything against a president that he had a grudge against. And I can't help but think about the Tea Party. And I'm wondering if you see any kind of cultural connection, or is this something that comes in waves in this country, or is it something that's just kind of there all the time?
I mean, Charles Guiteau was the maniac who killed President Garfield. He's a very entertaining crackpot. He was more or less clinically insane. What does he have in charge? What does he have in common with the Tea Party?
Or is there just kind of self-righteous and
I don't
just
know that I
want to
go down that road, man.
Well, but then the correlator is it something that kind of comes in waves in this country, or is it something that's kind of always there?
I mean, those are kind of two different things. Like one lone crackpot with a weapon, yeah, that comes in waves. A group of vitriolic, angry citizens who are mad about taxes. Have you met our founding fathers? You know, I mean, yeah, both things come in waves. The Tea Party, as to my knowledge, have not killed anyone, you know, have they? it's not a movement that I personally endorse or anything. I mean, I can understand where they're coming from, and it is, you know, it's always nice to see people getting involved in the political process, but there are certain things about them I find dispiriting and maybe a little confusing. I mean, I'm personally a bit of a godless heathen, but I was raised in a pretty crucially Protestant context, and in a lot of my values, I think, are still in that kind of, you know, fairly Christian, like one of them being if you can help poor people, you should try and do that. And that's just how I was raised. And I remember that first big poll that I think the New York Times did, where they're like, what is this movement? Who are these people? And they went and actually talked to them and asked them questions. And one of the problems they had was a large percentage of them, their problem with the government was that the government was too involved with caring for the poor. And I remember thinking, yeah, that's good, isn't it? aren't you, if you have half a heart, isn't that one of the things that you're supposed to be in favor of, is trying to help people who need help, you know, just out of human decency? So there's that part of I find sometimes one of the distasteful things, not just about that movement, but about politicking in general, and especially this, especially presidential campaigns, I guess, in my lifetime, maybe before, is all of the pandering to the middle class and families, and I understand that's like, we want that to be a lot of the country, and those are important groups of people, but there's a way that middle class families are pandered to that is kind of alienating to everyone else, you know? So I'm getting off on a tangent here, but I don't really see the corollary, but I think as a person, like I'm compared to, especially in New York City, where I know a lot of fairly fancy people who went to fancy schools, I'm just about the bootstrappiest person in my circle of friends, you know. But I will tell you that every success I have and so much of the foundation of what I've been able to do in my life comes from my education, which is public schools and a state university, and being able to pay for that using Pell Grants and the Guaranteed Student Loan program that comes from government programs. And so I really am a person who believe, I'm a person who needed help, and I got it from the government, and I have repaid that government in taxes so many times over, I should be a Republican, you know? So that's, I'm on that side of things, but I think if that's a connection, you're gonna have to write that essay, you know?
We'll just take two more questions, please.
Yes.
I'd be interested in if you have any thoughts on what might be done in Syria and...
What might be done in Syria?
What your responses are.
Wow. I think we should more or less keep doing what we're doing and supporting the freedom movement, but it's not really my area of expertise. I do really like my Secretary of State right now, though. And I think, I don't know. I'm really not, I don't want to, I don't think it's really appropriate for me to, I don't have any big ideas on that.
Last question, please.
But it wasn't really, it's not really one of, it's not in my bio. Did you have any big ideas?
Well, it seems to me you're pretty much hands off with any kind of entering of any violent issue, but it seems to me the whole world is simply watching, and whether that's the role of the world.
I wonder. I don't know how nonviolent I am. It's certainly an option I like to think about. Yes.
As a person who writes nonfiction history and a person who researches historical figures, what are your thoughts on the general fictionalization and use of actual historical figures as characters in popular media, like the Abraham Lincoln vampire hunter or something of that ilk?
I'm in favor, but when it's good, and I'm not in favor. But, I mean, I think there are ways that it can be. Really vivid and instructional. Yeah, I think that's funny, him being a vampire hunter. I haven't seen that movie, but it's a funny idea, you know. And that's certainly, you know, more power to him. I mean, there are ways, like take that John Adams series that they did on HBO where they dramatized the life of John Adams using David McCullough's book. I thought that was wonderful and very vivid, and it gave you a pretty clear, full picture of what was great and horrible about John Adams, you know? I mean, like, terrible father, right? But, you know, interesting thinker. And you know, like those depictions of him and his marriage, and there's that scene where Adams, when he becomes the ambassador to Great Britain, and he has to go meet the king. I don't know if you people have read the entire Declaration of Independence, but what he and his friends wrote about this king is maybe the meanest review of all times. And there have been times when I've gotten a really bad book review and I read the Declaration to make myself feel better, because it is just like enumerating all the ways that George is such a terrible king and why we need to like break off, where we need to break up with him. And so and there's that scene, I mean, McCullough writes about it too, but there's something about the film, because so Adams has to go meet him, this king that, you know, he started this revolution against, he said all these terrible things, and Adams has to go be the diplomat to his court now. And he's like, there's a long room and the king is at the end and Adams has to like approach him, and that's just like the longest, most awkward walk, and it's basically like a scene from a Judd Apatow movie, you know, where it's like so like everyone's cringing and Adams is just sick and like and so there are things like that I think just really bring those people to life, you know, that to like, who can't identify, he's not just some like marble figure, who can't identify with that, having this job where now you have to go be nice to this guy you spent years and years fighting against, like stuff like that. So I think that can have real value. I mean, I actually heard McCullough speak once, and he was talking about the severe state of historical ignorance in this country. And he wasn't just talking about kids, he was talking about everyone. And he was saying how terrible that is and how it's our fault. And if there's something you can do about it, why wouldn't you do something? And, you know, I think there are ways that, clearly, I really don't care about that too much because I've chosen to write books for a living. I've chosen to work in this medium that not very many people engage with, but that's only my own selfishness because that's the medium I happen to like the best. But for people in those other more mass media, I think that it can have a real value and really, spark something in people, and it gets to, you know, when those things happen, it gets the country talking about stuff, and, you know, even the terrible things, you know, like, I remember all the, there is this, there used to be, I don't know if they still do it, but the History Channel used to have this award show every year called, I think they called it the Harry Awards, named for Herodotus, and I remember one year watching it when they have these three historians in tuxedos talking about all the historical movies of the year. And I remember it was the year of Gladiator, and all they did, all the historians did the whole time was just shit on Gladiator all night long. And then at the end of the night, because the viewers have voted, and then at the end of the night they have to open the envelope. And Gladiator won, you know. But even something like that, it gets people like talking about stuff, or it gets people interested in like looking into things more, and you know, I don't know, it like at least sparks some kind of discussion or something. So
please join us for the reception and the book signing.
Thank you for coming.